Hey guys, welcome back to yet another video of this dynamic programming series. So in this video, we are going to discuss this problem, that is this unique binary search trees, right? So the problem says that given an integer n, return the number of structurally unique binary search trees, which is exactly n nodes of unique values from 1 to n, right? So when you have n equals to 1, your answer is 1. And when you have n equals to 3, you have these solutions, right? You have these five solutions. So as you can see, this problem was asked in companies like Microsoft, Amazon, and Adobe in the past 6 months. So it's a very, very important problem, right? So if you haven't watched my previous lectures of this dynamic programming playlist, I would highly recommend you to go and do so, right? And before proceeding with my solution and before proceeding with this video, please pause this video for a couple of minutes. Think about the solution. Think about how you can use a dynamic programming approach, because obviously there is going to be DP involved in this problem, since it's a problem in the dynamic programming playlist. So that's a hint from my side. So pause this video for 5 to 10 minutes. Try to think of it, how you can like solve this problem optimally using a dynamic programming solution. First, think of the brute force approach and then try to optimize it, and then try to resuming this video. So before we proceed with the solution for this problem, here is a message from the sponsor of this video, that is Unacademy. So for all those who want to become a software developer or have just become a software developer, Unacademy brings you a platform where you can get access to weekly shows, which you can watch live. Some of the shows that are going live soon on Unacademy are hiring updates in startups and major tech companies, eligibility criteria, how to apply for them, live mock interview sessions, pre-placement talks where HRs from top companies come and talk about their hiring process, top 20 questions which are asked in interviews and how to solve them, weekend projects which could make your resume stand out in the crowd, live journey of fellow coders working in FAANG companies, and many more shows like that. We'll also have an option to interact with the industry leaders on the platform and get a chance to take part in an online mock interview to sharpen your skill and get real-time feedback. You get all of this and much more for a nominal fee of ₹999 for the entire year. And with my code RIGHTTORIDDHI, you get this for ₹899. For all those aspiring software developers out there, you can definitely give this subscription a try. Also introducing you to a course by Yogesh Yogendra, who happens to be a 5-star rated coder on CodeChef, and he will be solving the CodeChef problems. He will be discussing how to approach a particular problem, what technique you should follow so that you will not be getting TLE for each problem. He will be discussing the time and space complexity as well. This course starts from 7th of August on the Unacademy platform, and it happens every Saturday night at 8 p.m. Also, you can use my code RIGHTTORIDDHI to get 10% discount on all Unacademy courses. Okay, so moving forward with the discussion of this problem, you have to understand a very unique property of binary search trees, right? So remember, binary search tree is a special kind of binary tree, okay? It's a special kind of binary tree with a special property, right? So it's a special kind of binary tree where what happens is, if you have a root, right? So let's say your root is 50. So all the numbers that are less than 50 or are less than root will go to its left. It can't go to its right. And all the numbers that are greater than the root or greater than let's say 50 in this case will go to its right. For example, let's say if we have root as 50, right? And we have numbers coming in like 46, 15, 1. These all will go to the left of the root. These numbers cannot go to the right of the root. Okay. And if we have numbers coming in like 51, 100, 200, stuff like that, these numbers will go to the right of the root. So always remember that if a number is greater than root, it goes to right of root. And if the number is less than root, it goes to the left of root. So we have to use this property, right, to solve this problem optimally. So now about this problem, when we have n equals to 1, we can only arrange this tree in only one way, right? Let's say when we have n equals to 2, one way of doing it is assigning 1 as root, right? And then we have to put 2 because 2 is greater than 1. Another solution is 2 as root, then we have to put 1 in the left, right? So these are the two possible solutions when I have n equals to 2, right? Now, these are pretty trivial values of n, so you can solve it like that. But let's say when you will get a bigger value, right? You'll have some values like, let's say n equals 50. It won't be possible to solve like this, right? So you need to come up with a generic solution. You need to write some code so that you're able to solve these bigger problems, right? With the help of this smaller sub-problems, right? Now, coming back, what is DP? DP is basically recursion plus storing the answer for each recursion state, right? So Why we do this? Because we don't want to visit a single recursion state more than once. Once we visit that recursion state, we kind of store it in memory so that next time we visit that state, we can access it from the memory, right? So this is just DP. And also this recursion is basically solving, this is just a primary thing of recursion, right? Solving a bigger problem with the help of smaller subproblem, right? So these are two very important things we need to keep in mind while solving a DP problem. And now we will see that how we can use this concept of dynamic programming in this problem. So let's say we already know the answer of n equals to 1 and n equals to 2, right? These are easy to calculate as we did it over here. And let's say we need to find the answer for n equals to 50. So what we'll do is we will use these answers of n equals to 1 and n equals to 2 to calculate the answers for, let's say, n equals to 3, n equals to 4, and so on all the way to n equals to 50, right? So what we'll do is we'll calculate the answers for each value of n, right? Till the answer that we need to find, right? So basically we will be using, so we will be solving this bigger problem of n equals to 50 by using the smaller subproblems of the previous values of n which are less than 50. And we are going to do it in a bottom up manner, and we are going to do it in an iterative manner. Now this was all about giving you just a head start to how to solve or how to think about this problem in a DP way. Now let's look deeper at the problem, right? Let's say for each value of n, I mean, it's okay that we are going to use the smaller subproblems to calculate the answer of the bigger subproblem. Like let's say when we are solving the value of n equals to 4, let's say we will be depending on 3 to 1 to get our answer for 4. And similarly, when we'll be solving n equals to 5, we would be using value of n equals to 4, 3, 2 and 1, right? But how will we solve for this particular value? For let's say for n equals to 5, or let's say for n equals to 4, we also have to figure out some way, right? Like how we can use the previous subproblems to calculate our bigger problem, like the current problem, right? So let's say that when we have n equals to 3, right? What are the possible ways I can take to arrange my 3, right? One possible way is number of ways when I pick 1 as root, plus the number of ways when I pick 2 as root, plus the number of possible ways when I pick 3 as root, right? These are the three possible root candidates I can take for n equals to 3. Other than that, there are no possible root candidates. That let's say when we pick 1 as root, right? So let's say we have 1, 2 and 3. So when we pick 1 as root, we know that in a binary search tree, towards the left, only the lesser numbers than the root can go. So if I'm picking 1 as root, right, then there is no number that is smaller than 1, right? So therefore, there will be no numbers that will be going to my left of 1, right? And to my right of 1, the numbers that are greater than 1 will go. So these are the numbers that are greater than 1. So they will go to its right. Cool. So now try to understand one thing. Don't concentrate on this 2, 3 for now. Concentrate that there will be two numbers, right, that will be going to its right of 1 when I pick 1 as root, and there will be zero numbers that will be going to the left of 1 when I pick 1 as root, right? Now, I'm solving the value of n equals to 3, right? So I'm first solving for 1, then 2, then 3 and so on, right? So when I am reaching, when I've already reached 3, right, I have the answer for n equals to 2 and n equals to 0, right? So can I utilize these two answers in some way to calculate my answer for 1 as root, right? Similarly, when I've solved this, now let's say when I'm solving this problem for by keeping 2 as root, now I know that there will be one number. So let me write this again. So I know that for this 2, there will be one number, right, that will go to its left, and there will be another number, like another one number that will go to its right, right? And we have the answer ready for n equals to 1, right? So can we utilize it in some way to calculate the answer for 2 as keeping 2 as root? Similarly, when we take 3, right, so there are two numbers that goes to his left, and there are no numbers that goes to his right. Cool. So we can also utilize these values we have calculated for n equals to 0 and n equals to 2. Therefore, we can utilize this to calculate our answer for 3 as root. And the answers we get from here, we can simply add this up to get my answer for n equals to 3. Right? So this is the intuition. Now, how can we utilize these two answers to calculate that what are the possible ways for this particular thing? Right? Let's understand with the help of an example. Let's say we are solving the problem for
n equals to 5, right? And for n equals to 5, we have to, the answer will be 1 as root, number of ways when you pick 1 as root, number of ways when we pick 2 as root, plus number of ways when we pick 3 as root, plus 4 as root, plus 5 as root, right? Now, let's say we are solving this problem. Let's say we are trying to find what number of possible ways when there is 3 as root. Now, I know that two numbers will go to its left and two numbers will go to its right. Okay. So now for n equals to 2, we have already seen there are two possible ways. In this case, there will be 4, 5 and 5, 4. Right. Similarly, for n equals to 2, it will be like 1 equals to 2 and 2 equals to 1. We have already solved this problem. Right? Try to understand that this 1, 2 will be paired with these two numbers. Right. So basically, I am fixing this 1, 2 solution. So this is 1, this is 2, right? This is one possibility. This is the second possibility for the right. So I'm fixing this for now, right? So to my left, I'm fixing this 1, 2, right? So I can try out this 4, 5. And also I can try out this 5, 4, right? Similarly, now let me fix this 2, 1 to its left. So it will be, similarly, again, this I can take this 4, 5. Right, I can again take this 4, 5, I can take this 5, 4, right? So it will be, I will be fixing this 2, 1, right? And this will be 5 and 4, right? So for each of the possibility of the left, each one of the possibility of the left, I will be adding right number of possibilities, or right number of ways, right? Or whatever number of ways I have to my right, or can I say number of possibilities to my right? Cool. And I will be doing this for each of my left possibilities. So it will be number of possibilities to my right into my number of possibilities to my left, right? So over here, my answer will be, I have two possibilities to my left, I have two possibilities to my right. So when I pick 3 as root, I will add 4, right? Now let's try to solve this problem. Let's say for n equals to 3, let's say we are trying to find the answer for n equals to 3, right? So we can pick 1 as root plus the number of ways when we pick 2 as root plus the number of ways when we pick 3 as root, right? So when we pick 1 as root, we know that, let's write it down. So n equals to 0 and there are two possibilities, right? N equals to 2. For n equals to 2, we already have the answer, that is 2. For n equals to 1, 0, we will calculate 1, right? So I have to understand this. That if it's a blank, right, if there's nothing and we have two possibilities of n equals to 2, right, that is, let's say 2, 3 and 3, 2. So this blank subtree will go with one possibility of 2, 3, that is something like this. We will get a tree like this, and again we have blank to the left and we will get a tree like this, right? So we are considering this blank as only one possibility, and in this way we are for n equals to 3, keeping 1 as root, we get these two possibilities, right? So always remember, for n equals to 0, we will have one possibility, right? So when we have 1 as root, we can see that is 1 into 2, right? So this answer is 2. And we keep 2 as root, then one element will go to its left, one element will go to its right. We know that for values of n equals to 1 is 1. So already calculated that, and this is 1. Therefore, it is going to be 2 plus 1 into 1, that is 1. So we also calculated this. Now when we pick 3 as root, 2 go to its n equals to 2 to its left and n equals to 1 to its right. This is 2, this is 1. So it's 2 into 1, that is 2, right? And we get the answer for n equals to 3, 5, right? So similarly, we'll calculate for n equals to 4 all the way down to the actual value of n we are trying to solve. So if I want to write a pseudo code for this, it will be something like, for I equals to 1 to n, right? N is the actual bigger problem that we are trying to solve. The answer of I is going to be 1 as root plus 2 as root all the way down to I as root, right? Because for each of the value of I or n, like consider I in this case, since we are running a loop from 1 to n, so it is going to be picking all the elements as root, giving all the elements as chance as root, and calculating for its left and right. Cool. So at the end, we return the answer for n. So what we did over here, we did two things. One, we use the smaller sub problems, the value of n equals to 1, n equals to 2, right, to solve our bigger sub problem, and also just to solve one individual problem or the ith problem, right? We picked each element as its root and solved it, right? So now let's look at the code, and that will give you a much better clarity. Now let's look at this implementation. So we are going to take a DB array. So this array is going to be n plus 1, right? Now I'm going to first initialize the DP of 0 as 1, right? Because we saw that for n equals to 0, we have to take 1. Now I'm going to run a loop from 1 to n, right? And we will run another loop, right? That is root equals to 1, right? Root less than equals to I and root plus plus. This is pretty straightforward. This is just a loop where I am going to give every element a chance as root and calculate the number of possibilities around it, right? So now the DP of I, so DP of I is initialized to 0. I'm not doing that. So ideally DP of I should be initialized to 0 over here, but in Java, whenever we initialize an integer or long array, it is initialized to 0 by default. So it is a redundant in terms of Java. So I'm not doing this, right? So my DP of I will be plus equals to the number of elements to my left, right? So it should be DP of root minus 1 into number of elements to my right. So that is going to be DP of I minus root, right? And once we are done at the end, so this will calculate my answer for I, right? And at the end, I need to return DP of n. That is the final answer I need to return. That is the biggest problem, right? So nothing much. We can go ahead and run this code, right? I hope I have done this correctly. Pretty simple code, and our sample test case has passed. Now let's go and run it for the public or private test cases, and it is successful, right? So the code is pretty simple, right? Just, you know, two for loops. The complexity is O of n square, and we are taking a space for this DP array. So the space complexity is O of n. Now there's another optimized solution that exists for this problem that you can solve using Catalan numbers, and it will reduce your time complexity to O of n. But I don't think that's very important for the interview, right? And anyway, this is a dynamic programming playlist. So anyway, I wouldn't be discussing that. But if you're interested, you can go and find out the solution to this problem, which solves it in O n. So that's it for the video, guys. I hope this video added some content to you and it made your DP concept more clear. So if it did, please comment down below, and don't forget to like this video and subscribe to my channel and press the bell icon so that every time I upload a new video like this, you are aware, right? So I will see you in the next video. Till then, stay safe and goodbye.